Well, we got our text here, and we're going to draw our attention to John chapter 14 as we continue on in our journey in these I am statements of Jesus. So let's see what Jesus has to say here, because in my estimation, it's a bit audacious. But let's see. Don't let this throw you. You trust God, don't you? Trust me. There's plenty of room for you in my Father's home. If that weren't so, would I have told you that I am on my way to get a room ready for you? And if I'm on my way to get your room ready, I'll come back and get you so you can live where I live. And you already know the road I'm taking. And Thomas said, Master, we have no idea where you're going. How do you expect us to know the road? And Jesus said, I am the road. I'm also the truth and also the life. No one gets to the Father apart from me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him. You've even seen him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Lord God Almighty, we do thank you so much for this day in which we have to gather before your throne to be engaged with your truth, to recognize the value of who you've called us to be and how we are to understand our posture before your holy throne. So even now, as we're trying to find the road to figure out how we are to live, pray that your word would come and speak to us, that your spirit would minister to us, and the words of my mouth and the meditations upon our hearts would be made acceptable in your sight. For you alone are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, I got to tell you, I'm not much for watching the idiot box, but there's times when I get captured and get drawn in by its tractor beam. And one day, this past week, Becky was sitting there watching one of her favorite shows called The Middle. Now, I've never really watched this show, but there she was watching it with Caleb, and they're having a cackle fest. You know, it is kind of funny. And I thought, well, I'm going to slip in here and see what all the fuss is about. And so I sat down, and sure enough, I was drawn into this show, and I was watching the very end of this show, and they ended it, and I thought to myself, golly, I've let this whole show for 9 years go by without ever watching it, but it really, I guess I lived it for more than 18 years, so it's not a problem. I could have written a script, I think. But so there's a scene in there. This isn't the scene from the last episode, but it's one that's reminiscent of the last episode that I think, wow, these writers got it right. So get a peek at this. Here it comes. We have to turn up the volume there, Brandon.
Really starts.
Feels like we've been driving forever.
Feels like we've been driving forever.
Cut it out, asshole. That's not funny.
That's not funny.
No, I didn't want to do that. Why are you so mean? Why are you so mean? Just ignoring you.
Wait, what are you doing?
Break
it down.
Break
it
down.
It doesn't work that way. Quit it.
Quit it.
Yes. How many times have I written that script in our car? I don't know. But we all know that experience. You know, you get in the car and you, this is my line. Don't trust the line. You know, you're touching me. You know, all this stuff. You do that repeating thing. Would you knock it off? You know, this is the stuff. You get in the car. You go on a road trip. And that's Memorial Day weekend too, isn't it? We get in the car. We're going on a road trip. We're going somewhere. And it just may be like this in the back of your car. I'm going to pull over. So the whole thing, that's part of our experience, right? Of on the road to find out things about life, about who we are, about what we value, about what it is that we find is important. Now, it's interesting. This past week, I met with a session, and we were talking away, and it was just good fun. And I threw out there as our opening, I said, you know, when you go on a road trip, do you use GPS, a paper map, or really nothing? You basically, kind of wing it or ask for directions as you go or kind of think through your head, yeah, I think I'm supposed to go this way, or use crazy landmarks that don't exist. You know, and I put that out there for people to think about. And they came back. And I know personally, me, yeah, the GPS is a nice thing. You type it in there. But every time, even when people, I get in a car with somebody and they'll say, oh, yeah, I got it on GPS. I said, oh, don't trust that. Don't. You can't trust that. And I know for me, I'll get in a car. I'm like, yeah, I think I know where I'm going. I'll go off and just kind of, yeah, it's up this way somewhere. And it's a great way to go because you just never know what you're going to encounter. It may take a little bit longer. Like one time my wife and I, we decided we're living in Boston, that we were going to drive to the lowest point of South Carolina, but drive the entire coast. Now, this sounds really romantic. I don't recommend it. You will get lost. And after 3 years, we finally got down to our destination. But it was really kind of fun, though. It was like, I don't know where we're going. Let's try this way. Okay. You know, there's no map, no GPS back in those days. We're just kind of going along, feeling our way as we go through. Oh, yeah. Oh, this looks good. And that's sometimes how we go through life, too, right? We're just kind of feeling our way and trying to figure out where to go and what turn is really a viable turn. It's interesting here in our text today, and Jesus says, hey, you guys know where I'm going, and Thomas is the one who's speaking wisdom. It's like, Jesus, no, we have no idea where you're going. And then Jesus makes this audacious statement. I am the way, the truth, and the life. What? You're what? Really? And I love the Message translation. I am the road. You know, I'm that pathway. It's going to take you to where you need to be. Wow. Really? How does Jesus get off the bus making a statement like that? When there are all these other religions out in the world, how come his gets the special billing? Why is it that he's the one who's able to say, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life? Seems pretty bold. Way back in the 4th century, the whole world had to deal with this question. Athanasius was at the center of it. And so was Constantine, for that matter. Because what he saw was his whole empire being split in half because of the issue of what do we do with this guy named Jesus? How do we understand who this guy is? And so they called together, and you'll see it in your bulletin, as the outcome of that meeting of Athanasius and all the other bishops that were gathered together and the religious leaders as they squared off between Athanasius and Arius. Because one guy, Arius, was saying, no, Jesus is just this guy, you know, he just had this divine light about him. He wasn't really God, he was just a nice guy who knew how to live. Can't have him being God, it totally messes the whole thing up. And Athanasius, the one, said, no, he is fully God. What? Yeah. You see, as Athanasius goes on to make his defense in how he speaks about this, he says, the thing we have to contend with first and foremost, my friends, is the reality that God became flesh. And isn't that what John writes in the very beginning of this gospel that we're studying, that we've been going through in these I am statements? At the very beginning, as John is making this thing known, he is revealing to the whole world that's reading his letter, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh. And the Word was God. And the Word was with God. Wow. The Word becomes flesh. It has to. It has to. In the beginning, God spoke things into existence by His Word. The Word spoken to us gives us the truth. And Jesus is the one who comes and says, I am truth. And he is in flesh. Because none of us have the capacity of being able to redeem the relationship of this broken world with God. None of us. And this is the reality of what we have to contend with, right? How do we really deal with the reality of sin in our world and to be able to reconcile a relationship with the one who called us into existence? How do we do that? Right? We can't. Only God is capable of being able to do that, to bring redemption to the broken world. And the only way he's capable of doing that is for him to come in the flesh and to be able to live and dwell among us and to be able to reveal what it is that God desires. This is what Athanasius goes on to say. He says, you read in the book of Hebrews and you'll see it is Jesus who came and had to suffer to be able to maintain, to bring out the perfection in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. You'll see that. This is what we know. This is what Athanasius was declaring as he was speaking to the larger group to defend the reality of what we now have as the Nicene Creed that affirms Jesus, who is fully God, fully man. Wow. This is what Jesus is declaring even then and there, because the reality is we have no access to the Father except through the Son. We don't know. This is why Jesus makes this statement. He says, you've already seen the Father. AKA, you're looking at him. You know, this is the truth that we have. God in the flesh is what Jesus is affirming right then and there with his disciples and all those within earshot. This is what we know. And we go on to realize that the fact is that Jesus isn't just saying, I am one of the ways. I am not the one who's going to usher you down the way. He's not saying that. He's not saying I'm going to point you into the truth. He's making a statement that only God can say. I am the way, the truth, the life. Wow. That's huge. And what we realize as well is what Athanasius was likewise recognizing, and as other scholars who comment on this text, is to say that Jesus is actually the apex and the center of all of history. Everything in history up to that point points to Christ and God in the flesh coming into the world. Everything after that point in history reflects to what is the purpose of history as God has revealed it through Christ. How we are to live, how we are to engage with one another. What is our purpose in life? That is all centered right down to that very moment when God took on flesh and came and dwelt among us. This is what we know. This is truth. And it's been attested to, hasn't it? Even by the acts of Christ himself as he rose from the dead and proved himself victorious over the very thing that separates us from God. And he walked amongst us. And we just celebrated Easter and Ascension and Pentecost. All of these things we know. These are the things that down through history that point to the reality of God coming in the flesh, redeeming his people and drawing them unto himself. Wow. You know, the sadness is, though, with this great affirmation, is the fact that arrogance comes into play. And so we as Christians, we can kind of go around and prance around, maybe show off our feathers and think we're the ones that have all the answers, and it's our job to squelch all other religions of the world. Because they're all off the mark. And so we have this attitude like, oh, you guys are bogus. We're the ones that know what we're doing. We got it right. You guys don't. That's totally wrong. That should not be our attitude at all. As we encounter somebody who's a Shintoist or a Hindu or a Muslim, it doesn't matter. And maybe it's even an animist. If we encounter somebody along those lines, we cannot look with dispersion upon them because they're only living into a reality of what God has already established from the very dawn of creation. You see, at the very dawn of creation, when God reached down into the muck and he pulled out that pile of dirt and he breathed his spirit into that pile of dirt. And he created humankind in his image. And do you know what it means to be an image bearer? This is what distinguishes us from the animal kingdom. Nothing in the animal kingdom does what we do. We are absolutely unique in the manner that we practice worship. We pursue worship. We are cultic beings. Every human has an innate, passionate desire to worship. And so all these other religions that exist in the world are only indicative of the fact of individuals trying to figure out on the road to find out, who is God? Who am I before this divine being? Every religion is built around that. Even an atheist is trying to figure out, who am I in this world? And this is something that we built upon. So as Christians, we don't go around prancing and prating ourselves about as the ones who know all the answers. We go and have a conversation with these people because our responsibility is, as we are empowered by the Holy Spirit, to speak of God in the flesh who's come and dwelt among us. We point them to the answer that they are longing to find. That's what we do. We have a conversation with them and we learn about their religious practices and where is the correlation that we can find that is able us to have a conversation that points us in that conversation to the reality that God took on flesh. That's what we do. We speak with them compassionately. We speak with them as ones who recognize that we are brothers and sisters created in the image of a loving God who has not forsaken his covenant. And in so doing, we assist them on the road to find out. We enable them to recognize that Jesus Christ is unique, that he is God in the flesh. You see, the problem is with Christianity is it's gotten so dang packed with baggage that even the term itself reeks in some people's noses because it's so attached to Western society. And all the values that can be not good. And so people will look at it and say, I don't want anything to do with that because it comes with all this other stuff. And we need to be able to peel all that away and be able to point to the reality of who is Jesus first and foremost and how we understand that his love is that which saves us. That's what we need to do. God in the flesh comes and reveals grace. You know what's really fascinating? As every other religion in the world doesn't have what we have as Christians. And that is the message of grace, a gospel of hope built on the reality that our salvation is not works-based. And it's only by the Spirit's intervention that we are able to restore our relationship with God. This is where we start our conversation. You know, the other sad thing that happens, and it's kind of relates to this story of something that I heard about in Boston. There's this huge chemical fire in this chemical plant, this massive fire. And so all these departments came to respond to this chemical fire. I mean, the flames just shooting way up out of the top of the building. And these firemen are all gathered around, and they're training their hoses up onto the fire. And unfortunately, they trained them in the wrong spot. They were not putting the water in the right place, and it was overshooting the flames and dousing the firemen on the other side. Totally dousing them. And this is what I think happens to us as a Christian church, because people who are outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ and they see the Christian church, they look at that and they say, I don't want anything to do with it. You guys are too busy pissing on each other. That's what we do. We get ourselves all worked up about certain things that we don't even need to fight about. We focus our attention on things that are well overshooting the ability for us to train the Holy Spirit's presence upon the sin of this world and extinguish the burning fires of hell. Because we're too busy about other things. And the world looks at that and says, if that's Christianity, I don't want anything to do with it. But it's only when those firemen were able to train their hoses at the right trajectory and at the right target to be able to diminish the flames, were they able to bring hope, were they able to bring a sense of peace into a community that was experiencing chaos. It's only then that we as a church are able to do that as well. We just baptized two little babies here. These little babies, these waters of baptism extinguish the fires of hell. That's what it does. And that's what we're to be doing. We're supposed to be those individuals out there looking to extinguish the impact of sin upon the world by the Holy Spirit's engagement with us. That is where we recognize, I am the way, the truth, and the life. We are following into Christ's footsteps that gives, built on truth, that establishes life, that is not built on death or any kind of hopeless emptiness that other religions or other ways or philosophies would promote. This brings life, and we know that it does. You know, it's funny, as I was preparing this sermon and thinking about it, there is a song by Cat Stevens. It just came into my head. I thought, you guys, we need to listen to it. Not the whole way through. It's a good song. It's 2.5 minutes, but we're not going to spend the whole time listening to it. But it's called I'm on the Road to Find Out. And at the end of the song, he says, you know, we need to kick Satan's sin. We need to kick Satan's sin and pick up the good book now. Pick up the good book now. Let's take a listen to those first part of that song. Just click that arrow there, Aiden. Here we go. I'll help you guys out. We'll go this way. Oops. Gone too far. Go back a little bit. And I go forward one. And it should be right there. Maybe not. We did have some technical difficulties this morning. Oh, there it is. Oh, good. On the road to find out. And you can listen to the rest of the song. It's a great song. Friends, on this Memorial Day, as we load up in our cars, we try to find out what's going on around us, embrace the day. Remember, there's a truth that exists. It's embodied in Christ. And he has given you life. And he is the road on which we travel. This is where our hope resides. This is what moderates our conversation. This is what shapes us, even as it shapes our history. Let us pray.